We have completely refracted the sternocleidomastoid and the trapezius, and the internal jugular vein is being medially retracted by my assistant here. We can see the branches of the cervical plexus in all their glory here. The first one, this is the C1 root. The next root that we see here, C2. The next root, C3. This is the C4 root. This is the main part of the cervical plexus. Contribution is also given by C5. However, the bulk of C5 root goes to form the brachial plexus, and this is the C6 root. Each of these roots, we can see they're being united by connecting fibers, and these are known as the primary loops. And coming out from the primary loops, we have the branches of the cervical plexus. The cervical plexus has got two components, a posterior component, which is the sensory component, and an anterior component, which is the motor component. We are showing the posterior component, that is the sensory component, formed by the primary loops. The branches which come out from the primary loops are these branches, which we have picked up here. They are respectively the great auricular, lesser occipital, transverse cervical, and the supraclavicular. Additionally, C2 and C3 give connections to the spinal accessory nerve. These carry proprioceptive, unconscious proprioceptive fibers from the trapezius muscle. The distal part of these branches are so small that they have been removed while we were removing the fascia. They run deep to the deep fascia, and they pierce the platysma and they supply the scale. Let's mention a few quick words about each of them. The great auricular supplies the skin over the parotid gland. It also supplies the parotid sheath with sensory pain fibers, and it also supplies the lower part of the lateral surface of the pinna. It also supplies the sweat glands over the skin of the parotid region. This is the only portion of the face which is supplied by the great auricular which is not supplied by the trigeminal distribution. When we are doing any surgery of the lobule of the ear, we anesthetize usually the great auricular nerve. The great auricular nerve is also responsible for carrying pain fibers in any pathology of the parotid gland. And the great auricular is also responsible for the condition known as auriculotemporal syndrome whenever we have any stab injury of the parotid gland. The lesser occipital supplies the skin over the mastoid region and behind the pinna of the ear. The transverse cervical branch crosses over to the anterior cervical region like this, where my instrument is showing. The next important and the largest branch of the cervical plexus is this one which we have picked up here. This is the supraclavicular nerve. The supraclavicular nerve is C3-4 and it divides into three branches, and we can see the three branches here. Lateral, intermediate, and medial. And these three branches cross over the surface of the clavicle. Rarely they can go through the clavicle, and then they pierce the platysma and they supply the skin over the upper part of the chest and the shoulder in this region. Rarely, in fracture of the clavicle, the supraclavicular nerve fibers may be injured. This is the nerve which is responsible for causing referred pain to the shoulder in pathology of the phrenic nerve irritation of the diaphragm. That brings me to the phrenic nerve itself, which I was mentioning. This is the phrenic nerve, C3-4-5. The phrenic nerve runs on the surface of the scalenus anterior muscle, and we can see it is running here. Then it goes behind the subclavian vein, and then it enters into the thorax. Sometimes the phrenic nerve does not have root value C5, it has only C3-4, but in this case, of course, it is having contribution from C5, you can see. If it does not have the contribution from C5, then it can receive the contribution from C5 from the nerve to the subclavius, which is located here. This muscle that we see here is the subclavius muscle. The nerve to the subclavius comes from the brachial plexus, and it gives a contribution to the phrenic nerve, and that is referred to as the accessory phrenic nerve. The accessory phrenic nerve then runs in front of the subclavian vein, and therefore the subclavian vein can get trapped between the main phrenic nerve and the accessory phrenic nerve and can be a potential source of injury to the subclavian vein. These are the sensory components of the cervical plexus which are present in the lateral cervical region. Of course, phrenic nerve is a mixed nerve. Not shown here is the motor component of the cervical plexus, which arises from secondary loops, and they are in the anterior cervical region. And these motor component, they constitute what is known as the ansa cervicalis, and that supplies the strap muscles of the neck. Some of them are shown here, but we have not dissected them out yet. These are the nerves of the cervical plexus that we wanted to show you.
Thank you very much for watching. Dr. Sanjay Sanyal signing out. If you have any questions or comments, please put them in the comment section below. Please like and subscribe. Have a nice day.